But we're going to start out now with an organization that a lot of you know is just EBRI, but it's Employee Benefit Research Institute. And our first speaker is going to be Paul Fronson. He's a senior research associate there. And I know, Paul, most but not all people know what EBRI is. And if you could just, in a sentence or two, describe what it is and then sort of tell about your lessons learned.
Sure. Well, thanks, Cliff, and thanks to Mark for inviting me to the summit. I'll tell you about EBRI in a second, but as I was sitting out in the audience all morning looking at up here, looking at all these tissues, I was wondering, what am I getting myself into? EBRI, for those of you who don't know, the Employee Benefit Research Institute, is a private, nonprofit, nonpartisan research organization devoted to studying income security issues as they relate to employee benefits. We're based in Washington, D.C., but we're not a lobbying organization. We don't take positions on policy. We are a membership organization funded mostly by membership dues. Our members are a pretty diverse group. I won't list them. There's 150, 160 of them. They're all listed on the EBRI website, so you can see for yourself that it's a very diverse group. It makes it very difficult for us to take a position on anything, since I'm not sure there are too many issues, if any at all, that our members would all agree upon. So that's EBRI in a nutshell, and afterwards I'm glad to talk about EBRI some more if there are any questions. I'm going to talk about two things this afternoon. Private exchanges, which I would, hopefully you've heard some about private exchanges. I hesitate to call them a new innovation, but we'll call them a new innovation for now, so there aren't that many lessons learned from them as of yet. And the other thing I'm going to talk about, as Mark mentioned before, is some of the research that we've done around high deductible health plans and HSAs. I guess I had the privilege of writing a paper on private exchanges in the spring of 2012 that EBRI published in July of 2012. And not having done anything on this topic since this paper came out, or was written a year and a half ago, it has been the one thing that has kept me busier than anything else, not just over the last 12 months or so, but as compared to anything I've done over the last 20 years at EBRI. There's just so much interest in this topic. And the fact is, despite the fact that it's a new innovation, and I'm spending a ridiculous amount of time talking about it, right now we could really only name three private companies that have recently gone to a private exchange. And that is Sears and Darden announced about a year ago that they would start offering it or moving their employees to one as of January 1st of this year. And Walgreens recently announced that it would be offering a private exchange to their employees as of January 1 of next year. Now, there are a few others in the mix. These exchanges are offered mostly by consulting firms. Aon Hewitt might be the poster child for them at this point because they're the ones that have signed up Sears and Darden and Walgreens and themselves, if you want to count Aon Hewitt as an employer. So that's four. Aon Hewitt has another 14 signed up for January 1st of next year, and we don't know who they are yet, or they haven't publicly made the announcement. They will soon. Other consulting firms like Mercer has 14 signed up, nine signed up for next year. Buck Consultants has 11. Towers Watson is one that we don't know how many they have signed up. But we're talking about small numbers. But keep in mind, small numbers, trends start with small numbers, right? So here we are basically at the beginning of this trend towards private exchanges. And these are the ones that I mentioned are mainly for larger employers. There are some exchanges out there set up for smaller employers, small to mid-size. That's Bloom Health, Liaison, and Willis. And some of those exchanges, I believe Liaison has a couple of hundred employers in their exchange already. So it's not something that was created as a result of the ACA. It's been around a while. But with small employers, you don't have that, you know, you don't have hundreds of thousands of employees in their exchange, though with Aon Hewitt, there will be, you know, the expectation is about 600,000 employees independents as of January 1 of next year, and that's a relatively large number. When it comes to exchanges, you know, over the better part of the last 12 years, I've spent more time, or just as much time, dispelling the myths about what they are in addition to talking about what they are. You know, myths like when an employer moves to a private exchange, they're sending their employees to the open market. They're not. Myths like when an employer moves to a private exchange, they're abandoning coverage. They're not. I actually see this movement to private exchanges as health benefits in the workplace evolving. And I think that's a kind way to put it. The less kind way to put it is that employers are finally catching up with the largest employer in the country that's been doing a private exchange or offering a private exchange to their employees for the better part of 50 years. And that's the federal government. The Federal Employees Health Benefits Program, we don't describe it as a private exchange, but that's exactly what it is. It offers about 200 health plans, 12 of them are national, and I may be off on the numbers here, but about 12 of them are national. They have about 200 HMOs, so they've got regional HMOs competing with the national health plans, and they also offer about a dozen consumer-driven health plans. This is an exchange that covers about 8 million people and spends about $50 billion on healthcare each year. But we don't talk about it as an exchange. But certainly you've got competition in there. And they've been doing this 50 years, long before the internet came along, to help people make decisions, provide information, do enrollment. I mean, there's a good mix of people in the room here, and I hesitate to ask this question, but hopefully I'll see one or two hands, maybe from the panel. Anybody in the room remember Walt Francis? Okay, I was looking at Roy. I knew your hand would go up. There's a couple others. For those of you who don't know Walt, he figured out how to disseminate information to federal employees about all the plan options that they have so that they can make informed decisions. He published a book for many years that I believe had satisfaction surveys in there, all kinds of rankings, all kinds of information about what was covered, how it was covered. And the book is still available. He updates it annually, and now there's a web version of it, so you could subscribe to it on the web. And in some ways, you know, the private exchanges are just catching up to what the federal government's been doing and what Walt has been doing in terms of helping people pick their health plans. And if you want to go to his website, it's www.guidetohealthplans.org. He didn't ask me to plug it, by the way. So we don't have to call these new arrangements private exchanges. I think it actually has, there's a negative side to it when it's called a private exchange. I could actually simply just say what employers are trying to do with these private exchanges is a couple things. One, provide more choice of health plan, because most people don't have a whole lot of choice. And, you know, we'll just take a quick poll. How many of you have a choice of more than three plans? Handful of hands went up. How many of you that put your hands up are federal? Well, probably not given the shutdown, but.
We have one casualty, by the way.
Yes.
I must interject that one reason one of our panelists isn't here today, but she has a great picture and bio still in the booklet, is Karen Murphy, who directs the State Innovation Models at CMMI. She can't be here for aforementioned reason. Please continue.
So, private exchanges. Instead of calling them a private exchange, we could say all employers are trying to do with this private exchange is provide more choices, more transparency on the cost, and maybe move to some type of defined contribution or fixed contribution when it comes to the employer's funding commitment. Though I would argue that what the consulting firms are trying to do, or what they have done, is really created or reinvented the wheel in the sense that they created the 21st century version of what the federal government's been doing with its exchange for all these years. Let me go back to my statement about health benefits evolving, because in some ways, what we'll see happen with the private exchanges is that they're going to basically reinvent what's happened with retirement benefits. And that's something that I think a lot about because we do a lot of work on retirement benefits at EBRI. But if you think about what's happened with retirement benefits over the last 30 years or so, employers moved from defined benefit retirement plans to defined contribution retirement plans. And probably, certainly the students here don't even know what a defined benefit plan is.
They're not going to
But basically, when employers move from DB to DC retirement plans, in a defined contribution retirement plan, the employer is picking the, you know, I'll oversimplify this. They're picking a mutual fund company. Some mutual fund companies offer 200 or so mutual funds, and the employer tends to narrow that down for employees and may tell them or give them 10 or 15 mutual funds to choose from the 200 that the mutual fund company offers. And then the employer is giving people the defined contribution that they can use for lack of a better, a more elegant way of putting this, that they could use to shop for retirement savings. Right? The employer picks the plan or picks the mutual fund company. They pick the choices. They narrow down the choices, and they provide some money. Same thing with the private exchanges. The employer picks the exchange. If the exchange is offering 200 plans, which some might, but you know they're not far, that far along at this point, but some are offering 25 plans, the employer can narrow it down in some cases to fewer choices and then provide workers a contribution that they could use to shop for insurance. And you know, I think employers are interested in this for a number of reasons, one being this defined contribution. The private exchange provides the vehicle to move to a fixed contribution or defined contribution. You pick your term. I actually like fixed contribution better because defined contribution on a retirement side implies a percentage of pay. And employers are really not, when they're looking at private exchanges, they're not interested in percentages anymore. They're looking at giving a fixed dollar amount regardless of which plan a person picks. So I like fixed contribution better. And there are all kinds of reasons why, and we can get into this later because I only have so much time for remarks, as to why that fixed contribution, why employers can't necessarily set the contribution and forget about it. You know, there are reasons why they'll have to revisit it over time. I'd also like to believe that employers are offering health benefits to be competitive in the labor market. I mean, that's why they've been doing it for historically in the absence of a mandate all these years. And now that we've got the ACA has, for some people, validated the concept of an exchange, and a certain segment of the labor market, the small group, will be migrating to public exchanges where employees are going to have all these choices. You know, I think some employers are looking at that saying, if I'm going to be competitive for workers, you know, if I'm concerned about recruitment and retention, and my workers see this public exchange that offers all these choices, I may have to start mimicking that just to be competitive. Because people may start to ask me, why can't I have that? You know, look at all the choices, you know, these workers have. Why can't we have the same type of choices? So if you believe that employers offer health benefits to be competitive in the labor market, I think that's one reason why they're looking at this. Couple of the comments. You know, the question about whether or not private exchanges are a vehicle for defined contributions, I think is you know, debatable. I think some employers would certainly like to move in that direction, but when you've got the affordability tests and the ACA, and this contribution is just another form of compensation, if the labor market improves, employers are going to have to revisit that fixed contribution. Mark said we have to talk about value on this panel. I guess all the panels had to talk about value, and I was told before this panel that I also had to mention the term nuance, so I'm going to try and nuance my remarks about value. You're welcome. Okay. There's some real questions about private exchanges in terms of will they create adverse selection? Or if you give workers a lot of choices, which most of us, you know, only about three hands went up when I asked if you had more than three choices. If you give workers lots of choices, are you going to see healthy people migrate to the high deductible HSA plans? And are you going to see less healthy people migrate towards the Cadillac plans? And so far, with the employers moving into this, they're not necessarily concerned about it. The health plans are certainly willing to participate in these private exchanges. And ultimately, we'll see how that plays out. I think there's a concern there for VBIDs in terms of where they fall out, because if you've got, you know, right now I think Aon Hewitt's finding with, at least with Sears and Darden, because that's the only data they have at this point, that a large number of people bought down their benefits, and we all know that there's only so much you could do with a VBID plan and an HSA eligible plan. So there are some concerns about, you know, what the role of VBID will be as people have these choices and how how it could evolve as these exchanges evolve. And definitely, we're at the early stages with these exchanges. There's, for the most part, no data, no lessons learned. There's some from the Federal Employees Program. I think this is a little bit different given the technology people have and information about claims data and being able to do some evaluations. But ultimately, we'll see how it turns out. I was asked to spend a few minutes, and I'll keep this real brief, talking about the research we've done in EBRI on HSA plans. We've done some research. Some of it's been published, some of it hasn't been. Where we're looking at full replacement HSA for an employer that introduced the HSA plan, we'll say many years ago, can't be that long ago because they just came about in 2004, but long enough ago so that we can follow people not just before the HSA was introduced, but for 4 years after the HSA was introduced. And for the most part, there isn't that type of research. I mean, the health plans have tried to get at it to the best they can, but we have a continuously eligible population. And what we've done, and you know, if you take a look at the papers, one published in Health Affairs, one we published ourselves in Issue Brief, and one coming out in the AJMC, and I don't know if I was supposed to plug that or not, but I did. What we have found is that there is sustained savings after 4 years. The savings is mainly due to reductions in outpatient visits and prescription drug use. But there are some short-term negative effects related to prescription drug use where when we look at people with certain chronic conditions, we find that their medication adherence rates fall in the first year of the HSA. They do start to rebound in the second year of the HSA. And unfortunately, because once we start cutting this by chronic disease state, our sample sizes drop enough that we can't, when we're looking at it by chronic condition, we can't look at them far enough out beyond 2 years. So we don't know if there would be more of a rebound effect than what we're seeing. But we are starting to see a rebound effect. The other thing I would just mention, and I'll stop, is that we're also finding that in years 3 and 4 of the HSA, an uptick in emergency department visits. And we can't link that, in all honesty, we can't link that back to reductions in medication adherence. We don't know if that's the cause. We haven't been able to find a link at this point. The results are statistically significant, and they get stronger in year 4 than they are in year 3. But that's a concern. And some of, you know, some of my members, some of my employer members that have gone to full replacement HSA, and the surveys show that more and more large employers are interested in doing that. Some of them that have been doing it for a couple of years now they're a little uncertain about whether or not they want to stick with it. You know, given that they definitely saw some savings in year 1, but then trend seems like it's reverting back to what it was before they adopted the HSA. And it may be that they're looking at the private exchanges and thinking that this may be a better alternative. Let's not force people into this plan. Let's let them choose the plan that they want to choose, and we'll just move to this fixed contribution model. That may be part of it, but it's certainly worth talking more about.
Great. Thanks very much, Paul. Just to underline the implicit point you just made, and that is, while this is really fast-moving stuff going on here, whether it's private exchanges or everything else that's kind of rolling out under the ACA and other things going on in the environment, we will be at a great loss if we don't conduct all this ongoing data collection and research. We're experimenting. Like we said, they're the fast winners and the fast failures. We have to have a data collection and learning mechanism to go with that all along the way. Otherwise, we'll miss out on those valuable lessons. So very, very helpful. Thanks, Paul.
Thank you.
We'll come back to a few of those issues. Our next presenter is Lonnie Reisman. He's the chief medical officer. Little old insurance company you might have heard of. It's called, it was Aetna. I think I've heard of it.
I can check my card.
Somewhere in the Midwest.
I'll check my card,
yeah.
But I think that's it.
In any case, I don't feel like Aetna needs to be on top of this from all angles. In your various plans and offerings, you cover a large swath of the American population, demographically and geographically. And Lonnie, if anybody can offer some lessons learned from that perspective, I think you'd be the person.
Well, thank you very much. It's wonderful to be here. So I thought I would present some information based on my journey with Mark Fendrick over the last 10 years, because it all sort of centers around having met Mark a number of years ago. And what I'd like to talk about are just some basic observations, some of the things that we've done that I think have exhibited some success, some new solutions that we've implemented where we don't have complete data, but we're hopeful. And then for what my perspective is worth, maybe a peek at the future and some of the things that we think about at Aetna and I think about. So going back to my introduction to Mark Fendrick, and I've got to tell you, he had me at clinical nuance. I mean, nobody talks like that, right? Except maybe me sometimes. So when he said clinical nuance, I knew I had found a friend and a potential colleague. But I think that notion of clinical excellence, clinical nuance, is certainly something that has always been important to me. I know it is to Mark. I presume it's important to all of you. And as I've sort of worked through my active health years, which I'll talk about a little bit, and hopefully grown into this role, a commitment to clinical excellence and quality has always been what's driven me. On the issue of clinical nuance, and I actually thought I would take the liberty of defining it since I'm not sure anybody really has during the course of the day. Let's think about a particular drug or disease, diabetes. And there's a notion of sort of universal coverage for all things diabetic. But there's a concern with that, and that is that not all products used for diabetics are good for all diabetics. So, for example, many of you, I suppose there are a few in the room who have either pre-diabetes or type 2 are taking or know about a drug called glucophage or metformin. Well, if in fact you've got renal failure and elevated creatinine, glucophage is contraindicated. So without the nuance of being able to say, well, gee, we're going to cover diabetic products, but anticipate or identify a contraindication or a risk that, in fact, outweighs the benefit, it would be paradoxical to actually support that drug. So that's a nuanced way of sort of homing in on the clinical literature, clinical evidence that suggests that something may not be optimal. Another issue, which I don't think I've heard today, and I just want to emphasize, is the very real possibility that the products that we would like to provide access to for our patients, for the consumer, may not have been offered to the patient, the consumer, by their doctor. Doctors make errors. Doctors have incomplete information. We might digress into a discussion about fragmentation and HIE. But the reality is, without the prescription being written, if we're talking about drugs or the order, it's not going to happen. So another part of clinical nuance would involve a recognition that in the absence of a provocation, the doctor suggesting a service, a test, there perhaps could be another system, a system like what we've built at Aetna, using our health information technology, to actually say, from where we sit, doctor, patient, it would behoove you to consider this intervention. We'll waive the copay in order to guarantee access. And by the way, before we made the recommendation, back to my first point, we anticipated potential toxicities and risks. So I just wanted to give a bit richer of a clinical type of example, really regarding what we're talking about with regard to nuance. The other issue, so the good news about what I just said, I think, is it's clinically responsible. The bad news is it raises sort of the possibility of discrimination. So if, in fact, I'm explaining to a series of patients that I'm going to, cover their drugs along the lines of what I talked about for a particular disease, but somebody else is taking the same drug for a different drug, say, for a different disease, say, ACE inhibitors, which are used for hypertension and nephropathy and congestive heart failure, does a patient who, in fact, is getting the drug for the wrong disease feel put off or discriminated against because they don't have the covered disease? So as we think about, work we've done in communicating this, I think it would probably be worthwhile to think about some of these issues regarding the points I've made. The other piece about discrimination, by the way, relates to sort of generic drugs, and I think, a perception that some people have that they're lower quality, they're not as good, they're being discriminated against as people from a socioeconomic perspective. I think we need to get over that. But just a few clinical points I wanted to make there. In terms of success, I actually sort of characterize success by programs that we've successfully implemented and then have been able to publish real results on. So one of my partners for years, and Mark's is Jill Berger, who's here from Marriott. And one of the first trials, I think, that we were jointly involved with involved Marriott employees as well as employees of another company, where we actually tested in a randomized prospective clinical way the degree of elasticity of demand for certain drugs. And actually the focus was on drugs with regard to some of the nuanced issues that I was talking about before, if it made a difference. And I won't go through the details of any of the trials I'm going to talk about, but in fact it did make a difference with regard to adherence and the types of things that we're talking about. So there is elasticity of demand. If we can intelligently highlight the drugs that are germane to the optimization of health for a particular individual, and part of this involves being able to sort of get granular and go beyond the population at large for interventions that will in fact benefit a particular individual. Another study, which I think you mentioned before, was the free trial, which we participated in with Nitish Chowdhury. So just very quickly, because we believe in what we believe, and we are aware of adherence problems, and there were other partners on this, we said, you know what, forget about, you know, this complexity of waiving lowering copays. Let's just eliminate the whole thing altogether. Together for the high-risk cohort, or a high-risk cohort, that we felt would yield an optimal clinical and financial benefit. So if you think about numbers needed to treat analyses, there are obviously certain high-risk cohorts where you have to treat many fewer people in order to see a demonstrable clinical and economic benefit. So the good news about the free trial is that, you know, we're good guys. You know, the usual, you know, classes of drugs that are administered post-myocardial infarction were given for free. So this isn't, you know, a cohort of patients where we're talking about prevention and theoretical risk. These people had the event, you know, they had some intern poking at their groin and somebody floating a catheter, into their coronaries. They had the real fear, the real event. And all we said was that, you know, for the drugs and, you know, the drugs, you know, antiplatelet agents, ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, statins, those sorts of drugs, we're going to give it to you zero copay. We're not going to get hung up about brand, about generics. We're just going to give it to you for free. And the good news was that adherence, in fact, improved. There were fewer clinical events. We missed the composite outcome, but isolated clinical events were reduced. And for this high-risk post-myocardial infarction population, that intervention ended up being cost-neutral. So what we saved on the basis of fewer rehospitalizations offset the additional expense of having to pay for all these drugs without any copays. So that's the good news. That's what we're all really pleased about. I guess that's how it got into the New England Journal of Medicine. This was about a year ago. The thing that I find really extraordinary, which I would ask this audience to contemplate, is that the increment in adherence that we saw that resulted in the desirable clinical and economic benefits that I saw was from 43 to 49%. We couldn't break 50% for free for a population that had just had a heart attack. So with all due respect to all the things we're talking about, this stuff is nasty, it's complicated, and we need to figure out other ways of going forward. We can do things incrementally, and I suspect it will always be incremental, but we've got some real challenges ahead of us. Another thing I wanted to mention, sort of in the domain of incentives, the kind of the carrot versus stick thing that we talked about before, is work that we're doing with employers all over the country involving metabolic syndrome. So one point, just sort of as a doc, look at abdominal girth as you are in Oregon, not obesity. I love the love handle thing, but you know, abdominal fat is completely different physiologically than subcutaneous fat. You obviously know that. And I've got pictures of, you know, all the nasty inflammatory thrombotic things that, you know, result from that. So you guys have it, you know, right in Oregon. What we added, this is not our addition, but for metabolic syndrome, there are also measurements around triglycerides and HDL and blood pressure and glycemic glucose levels. And basically, if you have 3 out of 5 abnormal results across metabolic syndrome, the risks are pretty much the same as the risks associated with frank diabetes. So all the cardiovascular, renal, cerebrovascular complications. So again, because we're such good guys, we said, well, gee, not only will we give you the test for free, but we'll in fact give you a reward if you score normal in 3 out of 5. And people show up, people get tested, and we're actually seeing really remarkable, profound results. I mean, I can't actually personally go into the cafeteria at Aetna anymore because everybody's sort of staring at me, and I have some bad habits, and it's awkward, so I sort of, you know, sort of sneak around. But we have managed, and I hear this from, you know, different employers who have done this, introduced a level of sort of awareness and consciousness about this, which I think is interesting. I don't know if it's a $300. I don't know if it's just an awareness of health. I also think that we need to improve the program. I favor paying people for just showing up for the test. So don't pay for the outcome if people know they're going to fail. And I also would favor, you know, paying people for improvements. But it just gives you another notion around that. The other point I wanted to make about this, which I don't think I've heard today, which I'd like to emphasize, is we've got to get off this sort of short-term, what's the one-year ROI thing. I mean, let's be real. This metabolic syndrome thing isn't going to do anything for years. You know, for many of the interventions that, you know, we're talking about, it's certainly going to be years out. So for all of you, states, employers, as you think about your own work and perhaps interacting with us and new risk arrangements, I think we've got to think about, you know, multi-year longitudinal tracking of patients, say pre-65 retirees into the Medicare population. Medicare ought to be interested in that because by the time they're 65 and they've had years of neglect, you know, clearly they're a lot sicker than they would have been. So I think we've got to be realistic about, you know, the temporal implications of what we're trying to do and articulate that. Another point I want to make relates to ACOs. I'm not going to do an ACO commercial, but we've invested a lot in technologies to support the abilities of providers, somebody said it really nicely before, to not just take care of the people who happen to show up, to actually reach out and based on eligibility, based on risk profiles, based on lack of adherence to medical regimens, to actually reach out and find, you know, patients. And a big incentive for the ACOs is they're going to get paid. They participate in shared savings. And as we think about exchanges, they can develop insurance products that can compete with the likes of Aetna and, in fact, compete effectively and improve their penetration. So there's lots of incentives for providers. And I think one of the things that we've been trying to, you know, sort of impart to the organizations we work, the ACOs work with, is that, you know, doctors need to be much more emphatic about the instructions that they give regarding the importance of an intervention or a drug. I'm as guilty, I was guilty, you know, you write the script, here are the four things you need to do, get out of here, I've got 7 minutes for you, as opposed to really being committed to driving adherence and using sort of the bully pulpit of the doctor to drive issues. So those are some of the things that we've done. Just quickly, a couple of new solutions, if you will. We've worked with Kevin Volpe a lot at University of Pennsylvania. He's done a lot of work with lotteries. So basically, if you take your medicines, you get to participate in the lottery. You can win a bunch of money. If you don't, you get you don't participate. The notion of hovering, peer groups. Turns out cohorts of patients are much more interested in being mentored by people who've gotten better, real patients, than a doctor or a case manager. So it has, I think it's related to some of the work we heard about social networking and communities, which may have more influence than some doctor. We're talking about prepackaging drugs. We're talking about social media. So this is, you know, something that, you know, we're very committed to. It's a critical point, and we're certainly committed to, you know, doing what we can to advance the science. And then the last thing I just wanted to mention, just for what it's worth, is sort of peek at the future. One is, as everybody sort of obsesses about big data and all the potential there, part of the issue is predictive analytics regarding who's not going to adhere, and arguably more importantly, what's going to be required to get people over that hump. Another issue, and this came up actually earlier from the pharmaceutical companies, there is a real commitment that I've seen by pharmaceutical companies to really go beyond, you know, let's get the drug approved, let's market it, to let's take care of that population. And we're having risk sorts of discussions with pharmaceutical companies and, frankly, medical device companies that feel a lot like the hospital conversations that we're having. So for a hospital, you know, we realize we want to empty your beds, but maybe we can sort of backfill them by broadening the population that you're responsible for. Same thing with some of the drug companies. We can improve your penetration. We can help you demonstrate the value. And part of the value, obviously, is going to be manifested when people actually take their products and adhere. So I just wanted to suggest that the shift that you're seeing on the provider side actually is extending to the entire supply chain as people reevaluate their position. And the last point I'll make is we haven't spoken much about genetics. but there's a lot of activity, as you all know, from a pharmacotherapeutic perspective, certain mutations and that relate to the efficacy of certain drugs. So as we talk about clinical nuance, that's going to be important. And then the role of genetic profiling to motivate people to behave more in keeping with the best evidence, companies like 23andMe. And then finally, if all this comes together, and this is probably a ridiculous fantasy, maybe there shouldn't be plan designs for anybody. Maybe we should see a convergence of ACOs and responsible risk bearing, optimization of care for every member, so the 38-year-old who's got bloody stools and is losing weight doesn't have to pay for their diagnostic colonoscopy, while the guy who's 50 and has no risk factors gets it for free. So those sorts of issues. So maybe responsible risk-bearing provider entities, no plan design, really just doing what's necessary for the patient and ultimately taking advantage of trends in the generation of big data and sophisticated analytics to really be able to optimize the care of the communities that we're all committed to serving.
Marty, that's great. Thanks. I can't help but notice the thing about the colonoscopy you just mentioned. When Fendrick explains this, he uses the colonoscopy thing. So that's translated well. Before we go to Dennis, I have to ask you something, because you kind of did something that I thought was out of character for somebody that's a CMO of a little health insurance company, and that is you said something that is said about companies like you. You said, we need to get off the short-term ROI thing. We need a multi-year perspective. There are temporal implications. When people complain about your industry, they say you only have an 18-month to 3-year time horizon, and you're now, as a rather prominent person in a company like that, you're saying, what's in your interest to have a long-term time horizon?
The interest is that our ability to affect the clinical and economic course of a population will be optimized over longer periods of time than we typically have.
But you lose a lot of those people to other plans.
Unless we have a commitment from an employer to where, you know, there's a paternalistic employer where people stay, or a state government where it's likely that those state employees will stay, or maybe a Medicaid relationship where, as people, we didn't talk about this, but as people go in and out of individual coverage through subsidized public exchanges, right, and then flip back and forth to Medicaid, you know, a single platform to optimize the care of those patients over time.
So you're okay with the churn if other stakeholders are playing?
And if they're willing to commit to us for a number of years. And
to that's you. Got it. Okay, thank you. It was a great thing to say. Wasn't sure it was going to come out of your mouth, but happy to hear it.
You're not going to tell on me, though, right?
No, it's I'd
No, we mean it. We actually have we actually have a couple of clients, a couple of states that have in fact engaged us in multi-year relationships in order to address this issue.
That's great. That's and good for them as well. Thank you. Dennis Scanlon, first of all, and yet again, thank you very much for filling in last minute, but you're hardly a fill-in. It's like you're usually a starting team member, so we're glad to have you. Dennis Scanlon's a professor at the Department of Health Policy and Administration at Penn State. He is very well known for having studied carefully and in an enlightening fashion a lot of the issues having to do with managed care and other payment and access issues. And we can't talk about lessons learned without having a really good example that may bring some chagrin to us, if I might say. So, Dennis, please tell us.
Well, thanks, Cliff. And I am not Karen Murphy. I'm merely Mark's backup plan. But lest you think I'm a little bit bitter about that, this actually helps me on two fronts. First of all, my kids have been asking, you know, Dad, what does it mean that the government shut down? And I now can tell them it means Dad gets to go to cool places like Ann Arbor to replace furloughed government workers. So I can also check that off my bucket list. So done that. I think also my role here is to make sure that we sort of balance the positive speaker bias, because I think that earlier in some of the presentations, we've had lots of good examples about how VBID-type design and benefit changes have really made an impact, save lots of money, improve people's health, and it can't be that good, can it? So I think it's important to sort of see some alternative stories. So I'll sort of take the train wreck approach and talk about what one might perceive as a disaster by my own employer. So anyhow, I do have a few slides. And
you have a few. We're not sure we're ready for them, but...
Yes, that's what's going on here, apparently.
I think you might want to start your story, and the slides will catch up soon, we hope, right?
Okay.
It's a colorful story.
There we go.
I've heard that.
Are we blocking your view, by the way? Or should we...
So I will get started. As I've sort of titled this, and you'll see in a moment, it's Moving Beyond Wellness Doesn't Work, an illustrated story. And I'm going to talk about the Penn State Wellness Plan, which many of you may have heard of in the past couple months that has been in the news. Unfortunately, part of being an illustrated story is to show you the slides, which are largely illustrations of kind of the trajectory and history of how this has all played out. So since I'm not merely replacing words, I'm going to have to describe these pictures that you otherwise would be seeing. So here's sort of the deal. This summer, kind of creatively in the middle of the summer, there we go. All right, how about that? Now I just need to figure out how to advance these.
Yeah, great.
Okay. So this story has several chapters. The institutional plan, the grassroots response, the media feeding frenzy, assessing the merits based on evidence, the retrenchment, and then the postmortem. And of course, you can't have a postmortem without blaming Obamacare, right? So we have to put that in there as well. So it all started in the middle of July, which for academics on college campuses is when, you know, we're all sort of out boating and swimming and nobody's around working, right? So clever for an employer to sort of roll out their new benefit design in the middle of the summer. And so Penn State rolled this out in its internal communications. They called this the Take Care of Your Health Initiative, announced ahead of open enrollment. In that announced ahead of open enrollment, it turns out, is very important here, because what they didn't announce is all the other plan design changes that were going to be rolled out and maybe announced in September or October in advance of November open enrollment. And these are pretty major changes, as it turns out. Things like moving from one singular PPO, which they did, Paul's point about having plan choice several years ago, moved to a single option, now moving back to multiple options for next year, including a high deductible plan. So things that are important when you're thinking about your health and thinking about your insurance. But what they did announce is their so-called wellness plan. Now, as far as wellness plans go, this was fairly standard for the most part. It included biometric screening. It included a health risk appraisal, which was conducted by WebMD Services under contract with Highmark, who is Penn State's third-party administrator. And that largely required setting up an online account, which would be populated with claims data from Highmark and end up forming a personal health record. And it also required filling out a typical HRA survey, although as it turns out, and I'll talk about in a moment, that really was the gist of kind of the employee backlash. It required a commitment to have an annual preventive exam if you haven't had one in the last year. And then there were some other basic things that many employers, frankly, are doing, a penalty for smokers and shifting cost for those who had a spouse covered with workplace insurance alternatives. In general, you know, the question is sort of, is this a wellness plan or is this cost shifting or what might you want to call it? But fairly standard in the industry. Now, the university was very much in tune with kind of promoting this. And so there were periodic, almost weekly announcements like this. Take Care of Your Health sees record participation following announcement. And I think this is really partly, frankly, what annoyed me, you know, the notion that everybody's signing up for it, everybody's getting their biometric screening. And the other thing I think that annoyed people like myself is the notion that this was all being pitched as though wellness was going to lead to savings to address the cost problem and that, you know, the world was going to be a better place, speaking of short-term versus long-term and kind of ROI. But frankly, the real issue that came into play here was the privacy issue, largely spearheaded by a political science professor who, after taking the HRA, basically said, you know, wait, the information that's being asked about here is intrusive. Why does the employer need to know this? This is private information. And to a lesser degree, but I think an important degree, at the end of the day, where does this information go and what happens with it? And how does that connect to improving one's health and less so, from his perspective, saving money? There's a fantastic YouTube video. I was going to kind of tee it up, but I think in the interest of time, I'll skip it and just sort of describe it. You might want to take a look. It's an exchange between, at an open faculty senate meeting, between a female faculty member who basically asks a Highmark executive, are you aware that this Take Care of Your Health or Wellness Initiative requires women to disclose plans for pregnancy in the course of the next 12 months or else be fined $100 per month? $1,200 a year. And that was the financial disincentive or the stick associated with this program. So the real concern were questions like this. Do you intend to get pregnant? What is your criminal history in terms of drunk driving and some other things? Just talking to Lonnie a little bit earlier, and obviously there's a wide degree in terms of variation of what's used in the industry regarding health risk appraisals. But this was somewhat over the top. And importantly, insurance companies take note if you're going to sort of do this on academic campuses. We understand things like IRBs, and so there was an issue of, well, how can they ask me these questions and force me to answer it, meaning there's no skip opportunity. You answered it, or you faced a $1,200 penalty. And how did that get through the IRB? Well, of course, this isn't research, but tell that to academics. Everything's research. So a lot of important issues here. But it was really the privacy issue that sent people over the top. So the rest of the story. Harvard Business Review. The danger of wellness programs. Don't become the next Penn State. Those consultants and analysts and, you know, people who have a vested interest in this multi-billion-dollar industry were sort of hovering around this opportunity. Blogs were going nuts. Twitter was on fire. The New York Times, on campus, faculty uprising over personal data. And these were really the two faculty members, Matt Wassner and this other guy, James Ruiz. But really around sort of information and privacy. My angle on this with my colleague Dennis Shea was really more around the cost and the ROI and the savings. And in all honesty, what really ticked me off was the notion of selling wellness as cost savings over the short time. I've done work with a lot of employers over the years, and I'm familiar with the evidence. And I think, honestly, anyone familiar with the evidence has to say that it's mixed. I think it's hard to make an argument that wellness doesn't work. I mean, that's counterintuitive, right? It's also hard to argue that there's strong evidence that it does work. But I think we wrote this white paper, and so I really decided to test academic freedom here, and we circulated this throughout, and it was kind of a fun experience. There's a lot of evidence out there. There's
you haven't been furloughed, have you?
not as far as I know. Rand, you know, has conducted studies. There's the paper by Baker and Cutler, which is probably the poster child for savings as it pertains to wellness. But the literature really is mixed. And at the end of the day, when you get right down to it, and we write about this in the paper, it's because what typically is sort of called a wellness program and manifested in a binary variable in some study is a binary variable that represents lots of different things. In some cases, it's an HRA. In some cases, it's an HRA combined with biometric screening. In other cases, it's other fitness or yoga or other type programs available. In other cases, it might be some intense coaching. In some cases, it's done very much integrated with the clinical delivery system. And in many cases, it's done by a third-party administrator and their contracted agent who, you know, basically calls you on the phone and, frankly, doesn't do much. So we talk about a lot of this in the paper as well. So as the story continues, there were a number of things. You know, this started to heat up, and the university sort of dug its heels in the ground and basically stuck to the notion, you know, that they were going to go through with this. A couple key sort of events happened. This was a statement by the APA, the American Philosophical Association, a letter to David Gray, the Senior Vice President for Finance, and to the Vice President for Human Resources. Dear Mr. Gray and Ms. Basso, according to an article in the September 10th Center Daily Times, in the New York Times, a health risk assessment questionnaire that is part of Penn State's new employee wellness program asked women employees whether they plan to get pregnant in the next year. If the employee refuses to disclose this, she is penalized $100 for every month she fails to yield up the information. And so you can sort of see where this has gone. So the media people sort of went into their room and it came out, and they basically decided that Penn State will suspend the fee for employees who don't take this healthcare survey or the wellness survey. And of course, guys like this felt redeemed. You know, Penn State eliminates the fines if you don't skip the wellness question. And this even sort of rose to federal policy level at Congress. So Representative Slaughter from New York basically took this on and said that, you know, we really need to address sort of rules for workplace wellness and privacy. And ultimately, this is the link to the ACA, how this wellness stuff is playing out, given what you may know as the Safeway Amendment. And so a key part of this, and what you see, and Paul's probably seeing this in terms of trends, you know, sort of nationally, is the notion that as part of the ACA and the so-called Safeway Amendment, that employers are now allowed to tie up to 30% of total premium cost to participation in some sort of wellness initiative. And participation can be done with both a carrot, it can be done with a stick, it can be voluntary, it can be mandatory. And there's some vague sort of part of that clause that says you can even go up to 50% with special permission. And I'm not quite sure how that ultimately plays out. So what are the key points? What are the takeaways from this lesson? And ultimately, how does this relate to value-based insurance design? So the first thing, I think, is communications. And communications are important in any type of incentive design when you're dealing with benefits. You know, is this about cost control, or is this caring about employee health? I think Penn State pitched it as caring about employee health, but because of the privacy issues, as well as more nuanced, some of the folks like myself and my colleague who knew a little bit more of the evidence on cost savings, you know, sort of saw through that and were somewhat skeptical of the true underlying intentions. And so probably not a surprise, but at the end of the day, how you communicate this and what your rationale and what your logic is incredibly important. Two, the evidence base. I mentioned a second ago, but I'll mention again the Safeway Amendment. As I understand it, and there's a great article in the Washington Post. If you Google Washington Post Safeway Amendment, you'll see this. This was written, I think, a couple years ago. During the ACA debate, the head of Safeway, which is a grocery store chain, was sort of out on the stump, you know, sort of going around giving talks at conferences like this, you know, basically saying how Safeway has saved a ton of money due to value-based insurance design and wellness programs. Largely wellness programs was the component that, that was being argued. As it turned out, and as this article sort of later captures, you know, the savings actually weren't really true. I mean, when folks looked under the hood and looked at the real-time period for which the CEO was arguing the savings occurred and looked at the interventions that happened, this was some temporal trend, more so than being tied to wellness per se. I think also the notion that, you know, I think in the case of Penn State, with reduced benefit staff, and this is an issue with VBID as well, is really making sure that you don't rely solely on those TPAs or those consultants, but you do your own due diligence, because there are lots of consultants out there, not surprisingly, that are willing to kind of sell you a song and a dance, so to speak. The privacy issues, first and foremost, I think convincing people that these things are important. In that YouTube video, I think the most, you know, sort of pronounced exchange is when the female employee asked the Highmark executive this, his response was something like the following. Well, you know, 6 or 7 years ago, I was a little skeptical of this HRA as well, but I took it and I found out I had issues. And, you know, my issues needed to be addressed. So I talked to the doctor about my issues and we got a plan and, you know, blah, 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 blah. I mean, you don't sort of go into an employee environment and treat a question dealing with pregnancy as, quote, an issue, right? So the respondent right after basically took him to task and said, I just want to clarify something. I'm an English professor, and I have an issue with your definition of privacy. Your response is that I can assure you that all the information that you provide will be kept private. Her point was, my privacy issue is that a conversation about my health and my reproductive plans is something I want to be private with my physician and not shared with some unknown third-party entity. So the privacy issues are pretty pervasive and, again, gets back to the communication. I think integrating or the use of carrots versus sticks. In this particular case, Penn State, you know, sort of was known as being the most aggressive in terms of using the stick approach, $100 per month or $1,200 per year. Had they gone the voluntary and carrot approach, this likely may have never happened. That's tended to be the modal response of most employers. And I think it begs the question, speaking of behavioral economics and you know, everything else we're focused on, is, you know, what's the right combination? But certainly if you want to use the stick approach, and there's good logic for perhaps incorporating a stick approach into perhaps some components of benefit design, I think it makes the communications and it makes the evidence all the more important. Behavior change, and this is really what I want to end with. The reason why I titled this Moving Beyond Wellness Doesn't Work is because, I mean, think about it. How can wellness not work? If wellness doesn't work, then we're all, I don't know, what are we doing, right? I mean, all of us in this room that are focused on health. It's, again, it gets back to what are we studying in the literature in terms of wellness, and what will it take to do wellness? What will it take to do behavior change? What will it take to get medication compliance? What will it take to have people focus on managing their chronic conditions. It's about individual behavior change, how I get a patient with diabetes or a patient with obesity to think about their life differently and what they might do. Very difficult to change behaviors. How I get organizations to change, how I get provider organizations, delivery systems, to do the kinds of things that we had in one of the past panels with the cartoon slides over on the right and think about all those other things like transportation and food and other policy, pet policy, as Mark said, that ultimately might have some impact on health. As one gentleman in the audience suggested, this is brand new territory when it comes to that kind of behavior change for organizations. And I think, you know, at the end of the day, this also raises the question of if our goal is to improve the health of populations and also hopefully reduce or maintain cost, are there alternative options for addressing cost, waste, and improve health? You know, one thing I scratch my head saying is for the university, you know, were they even aware of the Choosing Wisely initiative? If you want to save cost, I mean, there are professional societies that have come to some agreement about things that are being done that don't need to be done. Why not measure that baseline of those within our own population and simply see if we can find some clinical champions to go out and have those conversations? I don't know how much money would be saved, but certainly I think that might have been a more straightforward strategy. So the prologue to this, moving beyond wellness doesn't work. Again, the literature has largely studied third-party programs run by vendors with questionable trust and credibility. What I mean by that is, you know, not to pick on Highmark, but they are Penn State's third-party administrator. At the end of the day, they're out there beating the door of providers, negotiating contracts in provider networks, broad provider networks, and they're fighting over, you know, sort of fees. So they don't have a lot of credibility necessarily with going to these same providers and saying, well, we care about our, you know, employees' wellness and we want to partner with you in that. I mean, I'm exaggerating a little bit. I think there are ways to sort of get the job done. But from employees, they also don't have a lot of credibility because they're the ones that are processing claims and sometimes deny claims and everything else. So you have to convince, at least, you know, the burden is on the organizational entity to convince both the providers and the patients that there's value added here. And a lot of the telephonic, traditional-based approaches, frankly, have fallen short. I mean, I love the example when one of my kids were born where I got, you know, my wife got the letter from the medical director from a not-to-be-determined, I won't mention, health plan that said postpartum depression is a significant problem, you know, after you've had delivery, and I don't know what the evidence is, within 30 days or 60 days. I still have the letter and I have a slide made out of it because the letter came about 4 months afterwards, right? I mean, that's not good clinical management. So the future of wellness can and will likely be, you know, I think, much different in an ACO-type framework. It gets back to behavior change. If we're going to give population health responsibility to a group who might take on some risk or partial risk and might be responsible for outcomes, I think we will see better approaches to that behavior change, both in terms of wellness, but also population health and chronic illness management. And at the end of the day, that will result in the supply side hopefully owning, you know, wellness and chronic illness management, using appropriate incentives, taking into account both VBID principles and also what we know about behavioral economics. So that's the end of the story.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Dennis. It may be the end of the story, but it's kind of the beginning of the lessons here. And just, Lonnie, I'm just wondering, as you heard Dennis sort of unravel the story for us, are you thinking of all that stuff that could go wrong when you roll stuff out?
We think about this stuff, but we don't always do it well or successfully. Yeah. So we screw up, you know, lots, and it's always regrettable, sometimes embarrassing, generally not harmful to patients, which is our biggest priority. But
right.
these are very complex issues, and to anticipate various reactions from various factions that might be impacted. Right. Even the alerts I talked about before, yeah. But why are you intervening in the relationship between me and my patient? You know the audacity. What is a health plan? You're supposed to be paying bills. What are you talking to a doctor for, or sending a letter? Presumably, it had been more right. timely that speaks to my depression. So there are all sorts of issues that we need to grapple with.
Paul, do you think as someone who kind of follows this and does research on it, are we in a period of we're learning a lot, making mistakes, learning as we go, and that we'll reach a point where we kind of get our steps down and know how to do this in kind of a more smooth, predictable fashion? It seems kind of chaotic now. We've heard some great successes, but Dennis described how some very well-meaning people that seem to have thought it out well, at least originally, gotten a lot of trouble.
Well, in some ways, the I don't know if that's on.
You're on.
In some ways, the ACA sort of reset. I mean, we've been doing that historically, is, you know, trial and error and making adjustments along the way. And wellness programs aren't new. They're evolving. I don't know that we'll see headlines like this again, given
not.
What happened with Penn State. But the risk is there, given that, you know, the ACA increases the incentive to 30%, and in some cases 50% if the secretary allows it.
There's more on the table.
And yeah. Employers are wrestling with this carrot versus stick approach, and they're all jumping in or talking about, how do I jump into biometric screening and collect that information, how do I use it? So I think there will be more errors made going forward, and lessons learned from it as to how to approach this the right way versus the wrong way.
If I could extend, you know, the discussion from beyond wellness.
Sure.
and start thinking about high-risk cohorts, where programs that, I'll just call it optimization of care, whether it's the right drug or the right surgery or the right diagnostic testing or the right patient behavior for that high-risk cohort, where there's an incontrovertible clinical and financial benefit, so we don't have mm-hmm. to worry about, you know, the wellness literature. You know, what are our prerogatives? What are the things that, you know, we should be able to do in terms of maybe, you know, providing incentives for, maybe we should pay people to take the right drug or to go to the right value-based specialist or to the ACO that has demonstrated superior outcomes. So what are our prerogatives? How do we communicate those opportunities, being sensitive to some of the ways we've messed up? But I think it's useful to understand that, you know, we're focused on wellness, but, you know, the real sort of low-hanging fruit right now might be in identifying high-risk cohorts that we could really profoundly impact.
So, Lonnie, this brings up a point that you made about sort of big data, what you can do with it. Aetna's got a few reams of data worth delving into. And I'm just wondering, you also talk about genetic profiling, and then, of course, there's claims data. How equipped do you think payers are today, whether public or private, to get to the point where you can do the really identify these high-risk cohorts and the whole heterogeneity of treatment effects? Is it that whole range of tumor typing and genetic profiling all the way to what your claims are? Can Aetna sort of manage all that?
Well, I think that's the land grab, and that's what we're grappling with. We're partnering with other institutions, technology institutions, academic institutions, ultimately with an eye toward homing in on what is optimal for a particular patient at a particular moment in time, cognizant of the need to also make sure that that strategy,
right,
which we presume is optimal, is executed by a provider or in an environment, a team, that in fact can actually do what it is that we've identified properly, and then providing all the incentives. That's where we'd like to head. And the other piece, you know, along that continuum of information, of course, is the electronic medical record.
Yes.
And, you know, just consumer information. So imagine, you know, the patient actually providing data about lifestyle, symptomatology, the ability to intervene early on as symptoms are evolving, you know, suggesting a stroke or a heart attack. So all of that activity, and the question is, you know, what is our role, the nature of partnerships with employers, with providers, and most importantly, you know, the appropriate role of the patient and the ability to coax that patient into doing things that, you know, we genuinely believe, based on the best evidence, is in their best interest.
So what this is pointing out, and Paul, again, I hope you'll reflect on this, and that is, and then Dennis, because that's an application to how things kind of went wrong. If we're interested in extending the idea of the V in VBID, what means value, it sounds as though, from each of your three perspectives, you're kind of going in the direction of, you know what, value is something we can almost define at the level of the individual. And if we can say, you know, basically if we can kind of cross claims data, EHR data, some tumor typing and genetic profiling, what have you, and then some information about behavioral and preferences, the V in value is highly individualized, is it not? Dennis, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think about this from, I agree, I think about this from both kind of a macro and, I guess you could argue, or more of a micro level. Let me talk about the macro first. I think in In terms of finding, you know, if you think of an employed population or an insured population, you know, there's value in the sense of spending dollars where it's going to maximize the opportunity to maintain or improve someone's health and not spending dollars on things that are going to have no marginal value. So in the case, let's say, of Penn State, I think employers or, you know, Aetna or anyone else, I don't think we do a good enough job sort of communicating the true overall cost of care and how much is being spent. You know, I haven't seen one time where my university says that the average, you know, insurance policy for a family policy like myself is somewhere in the neighborhood of $15,000, $16,000 a year. And I pay, I don't know, maybe $5,000. I mean, that's a lot of money. Communication, and then sort of moving from communication to say, you know what, a lot of that $15,000, $16,000 in aggregate isn't spent on value-added services. Mm. In fact, it's wasted. And then go into some of the typical examples. This is where I think the Choosing Wisely campaign and things could be connected quite nicely. Now, of course, the point of that is to do that in a way to say, if you believe, you know, there is a wage-benefit trade-off, and this, I think, is the important component. Can we sort of partner between the payer, in this case the employer, and the employees, and say, you know, if we work together on this, we'll put more money in your pocket, and we'll basically take some of that waste and put it in your pocket. That's the macro issue. The micro issue is any individual patient in his or her encounter, you know, with the healthcare system. And I think there we get into, you know, sort of consumer engagement, patient activation, you know, the Wagner chronic care model and how the delivery system sort of interacts with the patient, you know, all those things, again, on the right-hand side of that previous slide. And a lot of that gets into behavior change. It gets into sociology. It gets into psychology. It gets into economics. And so I like to think about this both in terms of the macro level and the micro level.
That's a great way to lay it out because, I mean, I was just sort of focusing there on the micro level, but actually you've got to make the case at the macro level first, saying, you know, somebody's kicking in between you and what the company's kicking in is $15,000. Sounds like a lot of money. And by the way, what, a third of it might be wasted? Who knows? Maybe right. More. Got to make the case for having some new approach, and the new approach might even get someday to the point where at the individual level, we're saying, for you, the colonoscopy's free. For you, the colonoscopy's a lot. And for you, we'll pay you to get the colonoscopy, right? Does that work, Paul?
Well, you know, I'm listening to Lonnie's example before about medication here. So you're not even getting the 50%.
For free. Right,
for free.
Wow.
And
post-MI,
and,
not a
and,
wellness thing.
Right, exactly. For someone who's had a heart attack.
That was good.
And I'm sitting here thinking while you're talking about that the intern is doing the, you know, putting the thing in.
I'm just talking about what a horrible experience it must be, right?
Yeah, that alone is enough for me to say.
To take the drug, right?
Well, no, it's for me to say, stop serving those cookies at lunch. I'm not going to eat them anymore. Right? Because I just want to avoid, you know, having the intern do that, let alone anyone else. But I don't know that people think along those lines.
Well, we know what turns you on and off, so it's the intern off. Sticking the thing in. Okay.
Yeah.
That's so.
And by the way, just one other point on this granular. So
yeah.
I guess my rationalization is that, you know, the macro picture emerges from the aggregate of the granular.
Right.
The other issue is reflects sort of a flaw in, you know, our knowledge based on clinical trials reflects averages.
Yes.
So everybody, you know, will agree beta blockers are a great thing after a heart attack. The issue is the number needed to treat, you know, to prevent, you know, one heart attack would be like 30 people. So basically.
Right.
You know, the compelling example, the 25% risk reduction, yeah. is from, you know, 12 events to 9.
Yeah.
Meaning, you know, 97 people would have been fine either way. So, again, as we become more refined in our ability to pinpoint and predict the right. impact of a particular intervention, which gets back to this big data thing,
right.
But I guess what I'm trying to suggest is that we need to anticipate that level of refinement regarding the precision of our diagnostic and therapeutic approaches,
right.
and anticipate plan designs that, in fact, will accommodate that
Lonnie,
ability to define value.
Are you going to be there in 5 years? Can you sort of cross these? So take your point. So until recently, RCT was the gold standard. That's from where we drew our findings, and we always liked it when the mean, the median, the mode lined up, right? It tells us very little about the overall population. You're suggesting that plus these other data sources can get you highly individualized. Can Aetna manage something like that in a few years? Or you can be at
we're,
that point?
We're trying to do it. Let me give you just a really super quick example. So before we're talking about heart failure in the cartoon and all these social things, which is great.
Yeah, yeah.
On the other end of the spectrum, going on the clinical side, suppose there's a medical device, a pacemaker, that can tell me 2 weeks before weight gain, everybody talks about daily weights with heart failure, right? 2 weeks before your weight goes up, there's a change in the impedance, electrical impedance in your lung reflecting fluid accumulation. If I have the capacity, you know, to intervene 2 weeks before there's any probability of you showing up in the ER, is that enough? Probably not. But if I can do that with the cartoon, that's a sort of coalition, that's a sort of collaborative that we need to build, and that's a big part of what we're trying to do with cure teams and PCMHs and ACOs on a platform that can assimilate all of this information and then disperse activities that need to be carried out by various members of the team.
But and then carried out at the individual level.
But ultimately, the focus is the center of all of this stuff,
right,
is the patient.
And that differentiated patient, by the way. Okay.
Go
ahead, Dennis.
Add one thing there. I think these examples of kind of the cross-continuum connection in you know, the readmissions is kind of the classic example. Colleagues of mine and I did some work with an initiative that Commonwealth funded called the STAR program, State Program for Avoidable Readmissions. You know, what was really telling in kind of that work, I think, are a couple of things, and also the PCMH work that folks have done. One is more for the PCMH. I think it's when it comes to incentives, you know, sort of getting it right and whether the margins are enough to kind of, you know, move behavior. I think a lot of what we see in a lot of these things are that the dollars just don't sort of stack up to the extent that the dollars are useful. That's not the only thing that you can do. I think the other thing is just fundamentally the training, you know, of knowing, and we covered this earlier, knowing how to involve. I mean, somebody mentioned the area agencies on aging. We heard the same thing. You know, who are they? What? They exist. They can actually coordinate Meals on Wheels, and they can get transportation. You know, the people at the AAA will tell you that they, you know, haven't had these conversations with healthcare providers. Wow. They've tried, but they haven't been interested. You know, so there's the training aspect of things, and I think that this manifests itself in. So this speaks to your point about timing. I mean, what I was most struck by in going out and doing some interviews with people across the continuum, nursing homes and hospitals and pharmacists, is how, you know, the people at the hospital with their major nursing home, you know, who they sort of took patients from and sent patients back to, had just as part of this project talked to each other for the first time. So, you know, we wrote a paper, and I'm honestly forgetting where we published it a couple years ago, but it was largely around sort of expectations about, you know, these things are good things to do, but I mean, we are at some of those early stages of talking for the first time. I think what ultimately will potentially bring this together is the risk and the incentives associated with population health, mm-hmm. but time will tell.
No kidding. If folks have questions, we've got two roving mics. We'd be glad to take a question pretty soon. Well, we'll take one right now, okay? We'll take it right now.
Okay. All right, I'm going to be a tad maybe controversial, but I want to pose just a question or a hypothesis to the panel just to hear comments. So here it is. I've seen a lot of presentations today, and one thing that strikes me is it seems as almost as if in the VBID space, and here's the controversial hypothesis, almost as if timidity is getting punished and boldness actually seems to be working. So some of the things that seemingly would have maybe met with a lot of resistance, like using the Dartmouth Atlas and Oregon List to, you know, limit services, you know, actually seem to go okay, right? The CHF example of case management, you know, a pretty heavy, you know, a heavy approach, you know, to very expensive patients seemed to actually make a big difference. And there were several other examples today. I think you gave one on metabolic screening, right? Let's get everyone screened for metabolic screening and let's design a program for them. And yet the Penn State example shows that, you know, kind of a soft approach at maybe getting people to think about taking prenatal, you know, folic acid, you know, just completely blew up. So I just want to hear the panel say, are a lot of these wellness programs just too soft and fluffy, and do they just need to go in and implement VBID in a way that's evidence-based and is going to matter? And in a high-trust environment, you know, maybe we're just getting too timid.
Right. So. And just, we need to record again, name and affiliation.
I'm sorry, it's Martin Zagari from Amgen Health Economics.
I knew that. We want to make sure that our recording captures it. So you want to take a go at timidity versus assertiveness?
I'll start out by saying I think in the Penn State case, I think and I think this is true in a lot of programs, there's sort of an assumption that everybody knows the assumptions. You know, so, you know, you mentioned that, well, that program was, you know, maybe just about, you know, women taking prenatal vitamins. And maybe that's the case, but that's certainly not the way it came off. It came off as you're asking me intrusive questions, and I think the skeptic would say, and then you're going to use that to do something else with my premiums or my employment or something else. The point here, I think, is, you know, connect what you're doing to how it's going to benefit people's health, whether that requires their participation and their behavior change, whether it's a partnership with providers. And I think health plans and employers and population groups have done a horrible job of this. I mean, I've said for years with employers, you know, who say, well, hey, well, why don't we do a health risk appraisal? My first response is, what's going to happen to the information, and how's that going to change anybody's health? Where does it go? You know, that starts to get you into underlying assumptions. One assumption is, I fill this thing out, and it tells me, hey, you know, you're overweight, you need to exercise more, you need to eat better, and I have this metanoia. All of a sudden, I say, hey, I'm overweight, I need to eat better, I need to exercise more. I mean, you know, which percentage of the population is actually going to have that response to some information that's fed back to them? I don't know the answer. But I think that's one connection. I think the other connection is when it comes to change or it comes to compliance, it's the patient that has to act, but the patient can also need some help. And how does that information kind of coordinate with services, like some of those things perhaps on the right-hand side of the figure, that can actually help the patient? You know, so I guess that would be a first reaction.
Good.
Actually, two quick comments.
Go ahead.
One is, you know, evidence is key, and you can't speak to any of these issues unless the evidence is absolutely clear and incontrovertible, and there were issues with regard to what was presented there. The other notion that I just wanted to introduce is sort of suspicion and cynicism around many of these issues. And, you know, Mark knew me when I was a person, so I wasn't introduced as I, you know, typically am, as having gone to the dark side. You know, I get a lot of that. But people are awfully suspicious about kind of what's really going on behind the curtain and what the intent of these programs is. And I think somehow, as a cultural issue, we need to convince people that we're actually trying to do things that will ultimately benefit them, and to introduce a level of trust into this conversation, which certainly doesn't exist at a national level.
No kidding. I had a great conversation with a woman from UAW. Can you hand her the microphone? There she is, yes. And Dennis said something that you told me at lunch, which is about this trade-off between health care and wages. And I'm just wondering, having heard Dennis kind of bring that up again, do you have some reaction insofar as the acceptance or how receptive one side of the bargaining table versus the other might be insofar as these kinds of changes, given that difficult trade-off? And please identify yourself.
All right, thank you. Suzanne Mitchell. I'm the director of the Social Security Department, which is an arcane name for employee benefits at the UAW, and we work on negotiating benefits as well as policy and things like that from a labor side. The wages and the benefit trade-off is acknowledged at the bargaining table, and what I have been pointing out over the last few years to, as I told you earlier, we have employers with more mature bargaining relationships and some that we don't have as much. When you point out to employers that when you address a group, don't say, we give you this benefit plan. It's not given to a UAW member. They earn that plan as part of the compensation for the service they provide the employer. It is no different than wages. If you raise the premium by 10% and increase wages by a dollar, you have to look at the net. It's what over the term of that contract is coming into the pocket of the member. And the other, when you do it that way, then the cost of health care becomes something that the worker is more interested in. It's not just an employer cost anymore. It's everybody's cost. And wellness is a lot easier to work with. Trust is a lot easier to work with, because when you look at the fact that there's so much money in an economic package to go across an agreement, and if the healthcare industry is going to absorb it all, what's left for us? What's left for the employer and the employee? So that is something, that trade-off between the cost of healthcare and wages is one of the main focus. And healthcare is the main issue at every bargaining table.
So the presence of that at the bargaining table, which you explained so well, implies what for the inclination of either side of the table to promote programs like this?
There's strong motivation to the wellness. We look at the same studies, and a lot of that doesn't really pay off over years. A lot of it because maybe employees don't stay with the same employer for 30 years any longer. They're retired before they're reaping the benefits of 20 years of wellness, and then they're not having these issues they have with heart conditions and that.
Right.
So not all employers realize that, but one thing that we've done, and with Ford, we've actually got a pilot program going, and we call it Enhanced Care Program. We look at four chronic diseases that are eating up a lot of health care dollars, and it's all voluntarily. We went through the data mining with Ford. We sat down and with the VEBA, the trust, the auto VEBA, identified patients that would benefit from it. Their doctors reached out to them after, of course, there were agreements with the insurance companies and the providers and everybody else to join this program. And we looked at the Boeing model, and Boeing tells us they saved about 20% in healthcare. And it's just managing these four chronic diseases.
Boeing saved 20%?
In their overall healthcare costs. Wow. Now, they have a different population because they're all... They have, like, basically one health care provider, one insurance company, where in Southeast Michigan you have a lot of providers and a lot of different insurance companies. So there's different things that have to come into play, but
Right. Those
are the kind of things we're looking at the bargaining table.
Right.
It's both of our duties to try and bring down the cost of health care.
Great. Thank you very much. That's very helpful. Lonnie, it sounds like even in that context, there's a move towards some kind of individualized attention, right?
Individualized attention and perhaps an acknowledgement or a willingness to communicate over some period of time that if we all work together, we in fact can have the sort of impact on healthcare costs and ultimately compensation
right. By
doing the sorts of things that we're talking about. And I guess the suggestion I'd ask you to consider is and I think you're already sort of talking about the Boeing sort of 2020, the top 20%. People with established disease where, the ability to make an impact is on a much shorter runway, the evidence suggests what needs to be done. And if we can all get it done, then you see the sorts of results. And the question is, can you do it in a fragmented sort of system with multiple carriers and multiple providers? And maybe with some of these aggregators, these technologies, it would be possible. But I think that's where we need to go.
Excellent. Closing question, please answer in one sentence or less, okay? Just sort of based on what we've learned today and what you've just heard in our session, what you presented. From the standpoint of health plans, how would you answer this question? The innovation that I really want to see in health plans, what's really needed, where there's a disconnect now, the greatest kind of unmet need insofar as a true innovation in health plans would be what?
Show you first.
Since you volunteered.
I'm sorry. I thought you were looking at me.
I was going to start with Dennis.
Okay.
Audience left to right. Let's do it.
All right.
One sounds sentence, like Dennis.
Alex Trebek question here. I think innovation on the supply side for how to engage and incent patient activation and patient behavior. So sort of what drives, and I think that gets into psychology and behavioral economics and such. That would be one thing, I think. Just figuring out, this tension between, if we're talking about health plans, being the contractor and sort of the payer, and, setting up a delivery system and sort of a system of providers that can truly innovate around these issues.
Excellent.
I guess one sort of, maybe a semicolon, is... will that be the job of the traditional health plan, or will the health plan basically become the, sort of larger provider group, ACO type of region?
Excellent. Question mark. Yes. Very good. Thank you very much, Dennis Scallon. Lonnie.
I would suggest that we think about a shift or an extension from the focus on the supply chain, providers arguing about discounts, arguing with pharmaceutical manufacturers, focus on unit price and utilization, to a much more patient-centric approach. So the patient ought to be the center of activities. We ought to be thinking more about accountable care communities, which is actually a term that I've used, and understand that if we don't have it right from the patient's perspective and the patient isn't actively participating, we can do all the stuff, you know, on the supply side, but I would argue it ends up being sort of tangential to the real goals we're trying to achieve.
So innovation right around the patient. Yes, thank you. And those quite diverse patients, as you mentioned before. Paul, what is it?
And this sounded more like a newlywed game kind of question than a Jeopardy question. Okay. And I think we're all sort of heading in the same direction here with our answers. As we move towards more consumerism, consumer engagement, whether it's, you know, like it has been over the past decade or so, trying to engage people in their choice of healthcare services, and now with more exchange-like products, engaging people in their health insurance decisions, we really need to get to the point where we're providing people with the kind of information they really need to make informed decisions regarding their insurance and regarding their healthcare services. And we're asking people to do that, but we're not necessarily providing them the right tools to do it informatively.
Exactly. Well stated. Perfectly stated, actually. So please join me in thanking Paul Fronstein, Lonnie Reisman, Dennis Kelly. Excellent. Thanks, Dave.
You didn't say clinical nuance in the last sentence, Paul. I have to say... I might be the only one who doesn't want this to end, but I do have a bit of empathy.
I got that right.
I have a bit of empathy for Penn State because they're not very experienced in controversies that draw national attention, right? I mean, they don't do this kind of thing that often, and we are playing them in football this weekend. I've got lots of people to thank, and just a few very quick closing remarks. All the speakers, not only the ones on the panel, throughout the day, spectacular. Let's hold the applause at the end like the Academy Awards. The brilliant Cliff Goodman in his moderation. Milbank Fund in supporting the policymakers from around the country for coming here. Amazing audience from 28 states. The incredible VBIT staff, led by Caden Milkovich, our center manager here. IHPI for sponsoring us, and our many sponsors. And I'm going to ask, for those of you who still have your programs, to take a quick glance at the final two pages to see the diversity of the folks who support the VBID Center. And as I close, I ask for all of you to think about what you could do to keep the VBID Center viable as we move forward in these turbulent funding times. And then I'd like to turn to the back page as you think about keeping the VBID Center viable and realizing that our conferences probably are main fundraising activity, but to think what we do with a center of two FTEs and a dozen remarkable students from across the campus, not just on the national level with Medicare and testimony in front of Congress, the fact that we have helped change a national rule to allow VBID and Medicaid and actually see it entered in legislation here in the state of Michigan and potentially in other states as we're learning this week, the foundations, many of them representing here, supporting us, and our crowning achievement of getting into the ACA and leading to free preventive care for 105 million Americans. Not bad for two FTEs, I think. It's pretty good. We do our research because we're academics, too. I think our briefs, which you see on the back page, have impacted national discussions. Since it was brought up today, the students who are working on the Cadillac tax brief, which is our next brief coming out, you better hurry up to meet the need as raised today. As are our white papers, since specialty pharmaceuticals was mentioned, if Jason Buxbaum's in the room, we have to get our next white paper out fairly soon, which is the role of VBID in specialty pharmaceuticals. And I raise these resources because we make them all free to everybody. And it's the reliance on the sponsors and future sponsors who will hopefully keep it that way as we produce our services and remain open to any or all stakeholder who wants to deal with us and allow us to offer these incredible student involvement opportunities for not only students at Michigan, but now from students across the country, including our intern from Case Western who came up for the day. So the last thing, because the students will insist that I say this, is I'm obsessed with social media. I've told many of you, visit our website. That is really our home. We passed vehicular-borne incendiary device 7 years ago, so if you Google or Safari or Firefox, VBID, it'll take you right to our home. And you see we're approached on 700,000 hits last year. We want to hit 1 million. I hope you will also oblige me by following us on Twitter and the fact that it took us a long time to pass 1,000 followers. We hope to get to 10,000 very soon. And a lot of people tend to use our Twitter account to just get a broad stroke of what's going on in healthcare transformation from the variety of perspectives of the people who work with here. So, John, you said it very early on, John Selig, is that it is still, as much as we want to talk about health, Dennis, it's about healthcare costs that really remain the top point of the healthcare reform debate. You, Kevin, started with your deficit slide driving folks forward, and everywhere I go, I want to talk about value. I talk about value, and I'm about to get in the cab on the way back to the airport. The CFO will say to me, and how much money are you going to save me? I mean, that it always comes back to not value, but the healthcare cost thing. And I say this largely for the folks who have been with me from the beginning, and I'm losing where Andy Chasen is. But given a lot of the talk today was not just about the early VBID programs that were carrot only, and as Lonnie said, even the best situations, the carrot only programs like we did at Marriott and in MI3, they make people healthier and are cost neutral. But now with the discussion, open discussion around the country of low-value services and the advent of choosing wisely for us to get a conversation about making those services to non-Americans any healthier, making it at a higher cost to them and maybe not paying physicians for doing them, like Tony Keck said, I will say publicly at a VBID event for the first time, we can save money while making people healthier if you allow us to have the combination of carrots and sticks moving forward. And you should learn, Dennis, from Kevin and Joan and others, you've got to lead with a carrot, or at least the frozen carrot, like in Hartford, because leading with the stick will end you up where you were in Penn State, and you don't want to be on the front page of those papers anymore. So to all of you, thank you very much for your attention and attendance. Safe travels, and please keep in touch with us, whether through the web or through Twitter or any way you like, including carrier pigeons. Safe travels.